Hey guys, for the last 30 days, I replaced all the red meat, white meat, and fish in my diet with edible crickets. I took before and after blood tests, physique pictures, as well as tracking my recovery with my whoop strap. I also calculated the climate impact of my dietary changes. Here's how I got on. So there's been a lot of talk about how intensive the resources are for producing beef. There's also been articles along the lines of, are bugs the future of food? I thought I'd put it to the test by not only replacing my beef with bugs, but my chicken and fish as well. The first step was to work out how much meat and fish was already in my diet. So I tracked my food in chronometer, and it was just a case of sitting down and counting out the portions of meat and fish over a 30-day period. The results were that I typically eat 1.9 kilos of red meat, mostly in the form of grass-fed beef mince, 1.2 kilos of chicken breast, and 1.7 kilos of fish, which is mostly tinned mackerel. The total protein content across all three sources is just over a kilogram, which is equivalent to 35 grams of protein per day. The next step was to find an edible insect that could replace all the protein that I would be getting from meat and fish. There weren't too many options. Locusts and mealworms were a bit fattier, and crickets seemed a great source of protein. In their dried form, they're close to 70% protein, which is around three times what you're getting from chicken or beef. I ended up purchasing three 500 gram bags of dried crickets at a cost of £78, which meant I'd be eating 50 grams of crickets per day. Things didn't get off to the best start, so for the very first meal, I chose to fry them in oil and add them to mushrooms and rice. Because I fried them dry, they were incredibly chewy, and it took over 20 minutes to get through the whole bowl. The taste was somewhat masked by my choice of adding hot sauce, but the texture was quite off-putting. After that, it was much better. I was adding tomato passata to them to kind of give them some moisture back before frying them in the pan. I was making wraps and adding in other sources of crunch like bell peppers to mask the texture. Rehydrating with passata was something I tried several more times, including some simple dishes like crickets and pasta. I also tried three recipes which used the ground version, so first blending them into a powder, which retailers do sell directly. I have a no-bake flapjack recipe, which was then a straight swap from whey protein to cricket flour, and that worked well when I needed to prep my food in advance. I also tried cricket flour banana pancakes, which weren't that nice. The best recipe I found was for a chickpea and sweet corn bug burger from an Australian website, and I made four servings of these in the final week. The taste isn't that strong. I've heard it described as both nutty and earthy, and I would say earthy is the best description, not dissimilar to the pea protein that I have in the morning. So going through my results, starting with physical changes, I took before and after pictures and also used my electronic body fat scales, which showed pretty much no change. I'm not sure how much change you would see in 30 days, but it's useful to know. One change that did happen was my ability to recover from workouts, which took a noticeable hit. This took me back to 2018 when I was following Valter Longo's longevity diet for 8 weeks. With that, I was reducing protein content by about 30%, and I started picking up small injuries in the gym and not recovering by the next workout. The same happened here, so I strained my pec and also the top of my thigh in the first 2 weeks, and that was taking longer to heal. Slow recovery is backed up by my whoop data, something called heart rate variability, where a higher number is better. While it does jump around, it was on a downward trend when I introduced the crickets, and it only came back because I was tapering my training load for a competition. I did look into cricket protein bioavailability. The amino acid profile alone doesn't suggest an issue with generally similar levels to beef, except for a few of the essential amino acids. Depending on where you look in the research, you can find examples where insect protein is shown to be inferior and lower in digestibility. While protein is what most people think of from meat and fish, it also delivers other nutrients as well. I had some blood work done back in December, and then immediately after doing the 30 days of crickets, and I started drawing some comparisons between the two. My cholesterol was the lowest it's been in years, but that is due to a drop in both the bad LDL cholesterol and the good HDL cholesterol, meaning total cholesterol came down to 4.3. Red meat and oily fish are both said to aid testosterone levels, and cutting out both saw my levels of free testosterone drop by 22%. Then my omega-3 index dropped from 12.2%, which is a really good score, to 9.8%, which is still above the 8% value considered to be good. The omega-3 in my crickets across the 30 days totaled 42 grams, which is very respectable, but the amount I missed out from eating mackerel is a whopping 94 grams, and so my blood levels dropped. One final note on blood work is that depending on what you're testing, dietary changes may not fully be reflected until closer to 90 days. So what that means is that the results that I had are more about the trend and the direction they're going and may not reflect their final levels. The whole reason we're being encouraged to eat insects is for the effect on climate change. So let's start with CO2, carbon dioxide, which forms your carbon footprint. The units of measurement are the kilograms of CO2 emitted to produce 1 kilo of product. The first number I found for beef was 60 kilos of CO2 per 1 kilo finished product, but it varies a lot by country. Revising my search to UK beef brought that number down to 17.1, with a global average of 46. My other protein sources are far more reasonable. UK chicken is 4.4 kilos of CO2, and fish is around 2.6. I've filled in some other values here, including lamb and pork, so already you can see that even switching from beef to chicken makes a huge difference. So how about crickets? The data that is quoted a lot, including in this chart, comes from Thailand, where it's around 2 kilos of CO2 per 1 kilo product. Remembering that crickets contain 3 times as much protein as meat per kilo means it's about a third of that number when you're considering a per portion value. However, crickets like to be kept around 25 degrees Celsius, and my crickets were grown in the UK, which is 10 to 20 degrees colder than Thailand, depending on the month. I found one paper that tried to calculate the UK carbon footprint of crickets, and they came up with a per kilo value of 21.1 kilos of CO2 emissions. Dividing by 3 to account for the protein content still gives a value of 7, which is higher than UK chicken per serving. Running the numbers means that relative to my meat and fish diet, my carbon footprint dropped by about 25%, or in real terms, 11 kilos of CO2 emissions. That's similar to the carbon footprint of driving 35 miles in a petrol car, producing 50 eggs, or a single passenger traveling mid-flight on an aeroplane for 7.5 minutes. There are several other important factors to climate, including the amount of water required to produce the food, the other chemicals like methane, as well as deforestation that comes from creating farmland. In all of those cases, the edible crickets come out as a win, even if they're raised in the UK, so the overall climate impact is positive. Overall, this was a quirky but fun challenge to complete, and I feel like I've got all the answers I need, at least from edible crickets. While I couldn't find conclusive answers about insect protein in the research, my experience in the gym was enough for me to believe that there is something in the nutrient profile, bioavailability or digestibility that slows my recovery compared to traditional meat and fish. I hope you found this useful. I run quite a lot of self-experiments on myself, so if you like this sort of thing, please consider subscribing. I also write up a lot of this on my website if you prefer that format, and all the links to those are in the description below. Thanks for watching.